Hello. Welcome to my presentation about let's build a cross-platform 3D engine with Kotlin multi-platform. So first, let me introduce myself. My name is David Versteisen. I'm working for Marbuk Bank. We are soon to be a bank, and obviously we created everything in Kotlin. But I'm not here to talk about my day-to-day work, but more about what I'm doing during my spare time. I want to talk about games, how to create games. So, before talking about that, I just want to ask you one very simple question. Who's here, and please reply on the chat, knows this game? So, if you do know this game, just raise your hand. It's always good to stretch your arm, or just add this kind of emoticon emoji on the chat, please. So, Doom. This game was released in 1993, but I don't want to talk specifically about this game, but about the team behind this game. So, ID Software. And ID Software, you have some people like John Carmack. He's a very brilliant programmer, and he said developing a game on a mobile is an opportunity. Because it's easy to create a game for a solo developer. You can deploy it on a lot of different devices, and thanks to all the different app store, you can give it to a lot of people. It's easy for everyone to download it, to try your games, etc. And I was like, oh, it's a good idea. I will try it by myself. So I create my first app. My first app was Georing, because at the time I had an Android, and you cannot easily switch from normal mode or to ringing mode to silent mode, etc. So I was like, I'll create an application which switch your the mode of your phone regarding your place. So if you are to your work, it will switch automatically your mode in silent mode, etc. Unfortunately, this app doesn't have the success I hope. So I create something else. Create this time again, very simple game, just a cat head, and when you tap on it, you just get a meow. Very simple. But in fact, it was downloaded 10 times more than my previous app. So I was like, okay, I get it. What I should do is just create games, a lot of games. So I start to create some very simple game, like Rotapong, if this is a 360 degrees Pong with the Wizard, which is a small puzzle game, etc. So we will now see how I create this kind of game very quickly, and how I plan to create my next game in 3D. So my conference is about game development, multi-platform, and Kotlin. And the goal is that at the end of this conference, you will be able to know a bit more about game development, multi-platform, and Kotlin. You will not be the best in everything, but at least you will know enough things to create your own application, multi-platform application with Kotlin, and you know a bit more about game development. So, game development. What's game development? So, in a game, you have to deal with different entities. So, let's think about a breakout game where the player is just a small racket. You have the ball that the player will have to send back. And you can imagine some bricks. So, this is just entities in memories. You will have to react to player input, and each time you touch your controller, it will move the player. The ball will hit the bar and will send back the ball. So now you just move things, dealing with collision and etc. And after, there's a second step, which is displaying things. So your entities, this time you will use a sprite or 3D model or whatsoever, and you will display it on the screen. In terms of code, this is quite simple. we use what we call the main loop. And in the main loop, you will move every entities, like the player, enemies, the world, etc., etc. And after, you will render things on the screen. And you will do that 60 times per second. Okay, so in your game, in a 2D game, we'll talk about later about 3D game, you display things on some coordinates. So for example, the ball, I will display it on a coordinate X and Y. And at the next call of the main loop, I will clear the screen and I will display the ball at another coordinates. And I will do that every time, and that's how there is a kind of animation. To create my first game, I needed to pick a game engine. And in the market, there is a lot of game engines. One of the most famous actually is Unity, but you have other game engines like Love2D or Default, which is just now open source. And so I use libgdx. Why libgdx? Because libgdx loves Java, it's written in Java. And because it loves Java, obviously it will love Kotlin. Which kind of game you can do with libgdx? You can do some arcade game like AirDash. It will be released very soon on mobile, iOS and Android. But if you want, you can even do 3D with libgdx. Very quickly, I want to show you how to create a game with libgdx. You just need to download a project setup application. Configure it to use Kotlin, obviously, because you want to use Kotlin. And it will create a Gradle project with different folders. For one folder, the core folder, where you will put your command code. Desktop folder, Android folder for your Android application, iOS, GWT for web version, and so on. But the issue with libgdx is that to deploy on iOS, it's a bit more complicated. You need to use a bit of tooling. I didn't try it, but it's a bit more complicated than deploying an application on desktop and Android. And if you're using Kotlin, GWT is not possible because GWT uses the Java source code, not the bytecode, the Java source code. So obviously it doesn't work with Kotlin because it doesn't know how to deal with Kotlin source code. So my point is that with libgdx, you can create games, but it's a bit complicated if you want to deploy it on every platform. But if you want it, you can do it. Like this game, Slay the Spire. This is a kind of famous game, and it's on Nintendo Switch. And I learned that it was created with libgdx. I was like, oh, but how is it possible? I mean, it's quite complicated to deploy on iOS. But the team behind this game succeeded to deploy it on Nintendo Switch. And someone explained how they did that in a post in a forum. So in society, they did the port of Slay the Spire to Switch. And what they did is they took the Java source code, they converted it in C#, then they convert it again in C++. And I was like, okay, so if you want it, you can do it, but really, it's very complicated. So I'm like, bon, I want to create a game in 3D. What do I want to create a game in 3D? I want it in Kotlin because I love Kotlin. I want it in multi-platform because I don't want it to be very complicated to deploy on every platform. I don't want to buy any proprietary solution or whatsoever to deploy on Android or iOS. And I want a short feedback loop because what I like is develop a small game and be able to test it very, very quickly. Okay, so let's dive in now in how I build a 3D engine. First, for those who don't know Kotlin, let's say you do know Java. If you don't know Kotlin, it's very easy to learn. Just invert the name parameter and the type parameter, and voila, you just know Kotlin. For Kotlin multi-platform, it's at the beginning I was like, but what's Kotlin multi-platform? In fact, it's quite easy. It just say with Kotlin multi-platform, you can create a project that will target different multi-platform. So Kotlin JVM, to create a JVM application, Kotlin.js to create a web application, Kotlin Native to build for a native version of your application, and Kotlin Android. If you're creating an application with Kotlin multi-platform, you will get this kind of project. You will create a Gradle project with a folder named Common where you will put your common source code, a JVM folder, Android folder, JS folder, native folder. It looks like a lot, like libgdx. But this time, you don't need extra tooling to target any platform. So I was like, okay, I do know how to create a multi-platform application, but now the issue is that I don't know nothing about 3D. So I'm like, okay, my first game, I will tweak the system a bit. I will use instead one engine per platform. So for the JVM, because I do know libgdx, I use libgdx, Android, same thing. And for the web version, I replace it and I use PlayCanvas, which is a game engine, but for the web. And for native version, I use Relib, which is a game library to create, again, 3D game. And you know what? It's working. Here you can see in action three different, which is just a cube, but it's working on three different platforms. The web version, the native version, the JVM version. The native version is a little bit different from other platforms, but it's just because I didn't deal with Lite. So it's working, but in fact, I stopped my experimentation. But I mean, I didn't use that finally, because even if the rendering is almost the same on every platform, after all, you need to deal with file management. The file format for 3D model for each engine was different. I could adapt it for every platform, but it means create a lot of code just to deal with file format. So I stopped my experimentation. I was like, okay, I will not use different engine per platform. But I learned a few things. First, to target Kotlin Native, to interact with an external library, you need to generate Kotlin from header file. To do that, you can use a tool, cinterop. It will generate from a header file your Kotlin code, corresponding Kotlin code. And it's working very well. To be honest, I got the documentation of Relib, the lib I've used, and it was very easy to find the same thing in Kotlin because the code was very, very close. I did the same thing with Kotlin.js. There is here a tool named Ducat, which again, it can take TypeScript source code and generate Kotlin source code. And it's working, but not as well, like say interop. So for example, here it's code generated from a TypeScript source code, so it's Kotlin. Here it's working quite well, but sometimes you can get some strange class like this one, where the name is quite strange. It's because it's a dynamic object, so the tool doesn't know how to give a real name. So you need to change a bit of code, of the generated code, if you want to use it and if you want to avoid this kind of strange name. So using different engine don't work very well for me. So I was like, maybe I can convert this time libgdx in Kotlin. I mean, there is a very good tool in IntG where you can just take your Java source code and convert it in Kotlin. You know what? It doesn't work because the code base is very large. So the tool got a lot of issues to fix everything. And even at the end, you will see that there is quite some dependencies on the JVM. And it's quite hard to just remove all of these dependencies to fix that and get a multi-platform code. So my point is, if you want to convert a big Java project into a Kotlin multi-platform project, is not that easy because you need to convert it in Kotlin. Maybe it will not work in the first time. Maybe you will have to write it from scratch. And after, you need to check all the dependencies on the JVM. So I look for an API which work on all different platforms. And so I found OpenGL. OpenGL, it's an API which work on JVM, with LWDGM, which work on Android with OpenGL ES, which work on the web with OpenGL, WebGL, I mean. And WebGL is kind of OpenGL ES. OpenGL ES is a small subset of OpenGL and so on. And obviously, it's also available too on iOS. I mean, it's almost available on iOS because OpenGL ES was deprecated in iOS 12 because they want to promote instead Metal. Metal is another API to create 3D model, 3D things on iOS. So I didn't push very far my experimentation about using OpenGL on iOS, but it's working. You can display things, but when we compile, we'll get a lot of warning, like this API is deprecated. Let's take an example to learn all the vocabulary used in 3D. So we have a cube. A cube is defined by different vertices. So you have one vertex, another vertex, and so on. And with all these vertices, you get a cube. In the memory of your application, you have all these vertices. You can delete to move things, etc., etc. And with OpenGL, you will send this data to a vertex shader. This is just a small program that will be executed by OpenGL. And this vertex shader, it will just move like you want your vertices. Why it needs to move your vertices? It's because if you have a camera and if you're moving the camera, maybe the position of your vertice is not the position you think, but it's another position. So you can do some computation. And after, it will continue the rendering pipeline and you will use the fragment shader. The goal of a fragment shader here is to render your image by putting a color behind each pixel. Let's take a look very quickly on what a shader is. So it's just a little piece of code in C. It's a language called OpenGL Sharding Language, so GLSL. And you will run this piece of code on your graphic card. Let's take an example with a big game, very famous game, The Last Doom version. To get this kind of images, in fact, they first run doing very simple images with everything, with no effect. Then they render a new image of the same scene. They call it the normal map. And we did that multiple times to get a big map, a deep map, specular map, and we will mix everything to get the final images, which is this one. And so every step, it's data about how to render correctly the image. After, we just need to add some tonality on the image, add the user interface, and voila, you get the final image. If you want to know more, you can just check this website. It's a very good website where you can find some explanation on how games are rendered. Okay, let's go back to how to build a 3D engine, but this time based on OpenGL. So we have our common code and we have different platforms. So this time for each platform, this time I will, on the DVM, I will call WGGL. Android, I will call OpenGL ES. On Kotlin, on JavaScript, I will call WebGL and native OpenGL. Alors, you're like, oh, cool, a 3D game engine which uses OpenGL. Maybe this is what you expect. To be honest, if you're using my 3D game engine, this is what you will get. Alors, why? Because I'm not good in 3D, so obviously I cannot do a very complicated scene. I'm doing that on spare time, so I didn't push the things so far. But it's working. But to be honest, if you really want to know what you can do with 3D, just check Zenly website. The front page is a WebGL application. So I think that if you're doing it correctly, you can do this kind of graphics with Kotlin Multiplatform and OpenGL. But even for my 3D game engine, it's simple, but it's because I like to play simple games like A Short Hike. This is not the best, the most beautiful game in the world, but it's a very funny game, and the style is, you remember the style of the game because it's very simple. And so here, this is just one developer that created this game. So the issue is dealing with multi-platform, it's that you have to deal with obviously different platforms. So that's why you use Delta to manage different time. But my point is not here just to talk about this Delta. What is this Delta? It's time between two frame rendering, but is it seconds, milliseconds, minutes? You don't know it. So everyone knows that most of the time it's seconds, but you can be explicit with Kotlin just by declaring a type ls. You will say, okay, float here, the name will be second. The compiler will not change anything. I mean, if you put a float and you're calling this render method, it will not say anything because you didn't say it's a second. But at least it will act like a bit of documentation. Another example, because each time I'm like, I don't know the unit of the field, it's when you're doing a rotation, you need to get give an angle, which is a float, but is it radian or degree? And thanks to type allies, I can just say, okay, it's gonna be a degree. I can again use just simple float, but at least if I'm looking the signature of a method, I do know that it's degree and not radian. So this is a 3D engine, so we have to deal with different coordinates, so like a 2D game X and Y, with a new coordinate Z. To put a model in your 3D space, you have to do some transformation. So for example, a transition to move your object in a specific place, you will be able to rotate it because you want it to face you or to just turn it. And last transformation, you can scale it to make it smaller or bigger. And to do all these transformation, you can use some metrics. So not this metrics, sorry, but this metrics. And in this metrics, in fact, you have everything. One part of the metrics will represent the transition where you move your object. Another part of this metrics will keep the rotation of your 3D model. And last part is going to be about the scale. So you have to deal a lot with metrics when you're doing 3D. And you can do just some math to exactly say where your 3D model will be. So here, let's imagine a 3D model at the origin. I want to move it. So I will create a transition matrix and I will multiply my 3D model, the matrix of my 3D model with a matrix of transition. If I want to move it again, I will create a new matrix and I will multiply it again with the previous matrix. And so on. So I can do that with rotation. So you get it. If you're doing 3D, you will have to deal with metrics a lot. But instead of creating my matrix library by myself, I use already existing matrix library here, Kotlin Maft. It was created by Romain Guy, and you can check one of his talks at the Kotlin Conf from 2 years ago. And he gave a lot of examples of how he used Kotlin in his library. Very quickly, we will check 2 or 3 examples. So here, as you notice, I'm doing a lot of multiplication of matrix. And what's cool with Kotlin is that you can create new operators. So here, operator fun times means I will create the star operator. So I can do some multiplication. And it's way better to use this kind of operator. It's way more logical to read this kind of code than calling another method, even if the result will be the same. We notice that the metrics store some information, like the return station. But how to access this kind of field? Maybe we'll be like, oh, but the metrics, this is just an array, so I can access it by indices. But in fact, in the code, it's not easy. You don't want to deal with that in your code. You don't want to remember all indices. It's quite complicated. And what I really liked in this library is that there is some field which act as aliases. So on the metrics, I can just say, okay, I want to use the scale. To get the scale, I can just call the field scale and it will get the right values in the memory model. Translation, the same thing. We can notice that every alias is in this example return float tree. And float tree is a type in this library which contains only three values: x, y, and z. So for example, it's a position. But sometimes you need to deal with color, and color again it's RGB. And again, it creates some aliases to get the red color, the green color, the blue color. It's not a big deal, but it's quite useful because, in fact, when you're dealing with a float tree and you see that someone using the art field, it means that this float tree, in fact, represents a color. And if it's using instead of X, you do know that here you're in the context of dealing with positions. So about still again the float tree, cool things with Kotlin. It's storing three values, but you can access it directly from your object by using destructuring variable. It means if you want to do some computation on the x, instead of doing mat4.transition.x, mat4.transition.z, extra, extra, you can just extract it from the object by using this kind of syntax and use it in your computation. So this kind of libraries is very cool. It shows some good use of Kotlin. But how I convert it into a multi-platform project? In fact, it's not very complicated. You take the Gradle file, you add a plugin, so here Kotlin multi-platform. Then after, you have to declare which target you want to use in your project. So here I just say I want it to compile for JavaScript, a JavaScript version, a DVL version. You define all the source set, so where is located your common code, where is located your JavaScript code, where is located your DVM code. And after, you have to find all the dependencies with DVM. So here in the code, you can find a strict map which is part of the package java.long.strictmap. And so obviously it's JVM specific, so you need to remove that. Fortunately, there is the same thing directly in Kotlin, so I just need to replace this piece of code, and voila, the project is multi-platform ready. It will generate different packages, so because I target different platforms, I will get a jar for the JVM, a JavaScript file for the web version, and a klib, which is a file for the native version. So now let's create a bit of code with multi-platform. So there is different way to create a code that is common for everything and a bit specific for each platform. For example, I create an interface GL which hide in fact how I use which implementation of OpenGL I'm using. So this is just an interface, and in my platform module, specific platform module, so JavaScript, for the JavaScript version, for example, I will just implement this interface, and I will call the real implementation of OpenGL from this specific platform. So it's one way of dealing with common code and specific code for each platform. There's a new way. Maybe you already know this way. It's based on two keywords, actual and expect. So in your common code, you create expect class. And in your platform code, you will create an actual which have the same signature, the same meta name, etc., etc. You can tweak it a bit, like by adding some fields that will be available only in the platform code. But to be honest, I didn't find the best rule to know if you need to create an interface and an implementation or to use an expect actual keyword. In the document, they give some advice. Like, if you're using a form, you maybe want to use this API without using a wrapper. But to be honest, I didn't encounter this kind of use case. So this is not the rule I apply the most. But I found something that I was like, okay, here this is the best example to do know if you need to use actual or expect. So my use case is I will create an expect and actual class, but it's gonna be my native code, my GVM code instead, that will produce the instance of this this type. It will be consumed by the common, it will be used by the common code, and after it will be pushed back in the native code, in the GVM code. And by using expect and actual, I don't need to cast it because it's going to be automatically the right type, and I will access the field that is only available on the GVM without need to cast anything. So this is the rule I'm using now, is to, if the code needs to be to go in the common code and go back in the GVM code, I need to use expect and actual. Let's draw our first triangle. Alors, very quickly. In OpenGL, you need to define buffers, and after you have to send all your data. So here I will send all the position of all my vertices, and the data will be aligned. It means it's going to be one array with all the vertices I want to display. I need to configure this buffer. And so here it's coordinates. So coordinates, it's X, Y, and Z. So it's only three float. So I say, okay, so in my big array, you need to group everything by three values. For colors, I will do the same things, but this time, obviously, I will group values by four because I have a red value, the green value, the blue value, and the alpha value. And last things, it's to send the order of all vertices. And the order is very important. Because if you want to draw something with one order, here for example A, B, C, then I will say the order it's B, E, D, I got this shape. But if I'm using another order, so A, B, C again, but this time C, D, E, I will get a new result. I'm using the same vertices, but a different order, so I will get a different result. At the end, there is quite a lot of code, so I need to deal with vertices, colors and order, but the good news is once you did that, it's almost over. It's always the same thing. After we going in the vertex shader, so the vertex shader is where you need to deal with position of every vertices. We don't do any transformation, so this time we just say, okay, the result of my transformation is just the value, the existing value. Same thing for color. The color that will be displayed is just the color I'll send before. And I will get this. It can be a bit awkward because you're like, okay, I defined three vertices for my triangle, three colors, but in fact, I got a lot of color in my triangle. It's because OpenGL will interpolate color between two vertices. Let's add more complicated things. So in 3D, you have to deal with camera. And a camera, it's like in a movie. So you can move it, but you can change the focal too. So for example, here, if I'm changing the focal, so the example here is from Blender, a 3D program. I just change the focal and now I get a wide angle on my camera. I can use another kind of camera, which is orthographic, and this one is a bit special. It's even if an object is very far, it's gonna be the same size on the screen. While with a perspective camera, it's more like an eye. When something is far, it's small. When it's close, it's big. With perspective camera, you need to deal with frustration. So it just say it's like a cone, and so it stops something somewhere and it starts somewhere. So you can say, okay, here in this example, I will not display, that's why the cube is a little bit cut. And here I will do the same thing, but I will not display everything in the front. That's why, again, the cube is a little bit cut. But this is just for your information. There is a funny thing in 3D, is that maybe you think that the camera is moving around object, but in fact, there is a trick. This is the world that's moving, and the camera will never move. Why? It took me a long bit of time to understand why, but someone explained to me, again, it's Romain Mangy, by the way. If you have this kind of rendering, obviously you have to deal with values. All your vertices are represented by float. So, but if an object is close to the camera and the camera is close to the origin, everything is very close to zero, and with float, the precision is very high when everything is close to zero. But with big numbers, it's not the same thing. You're losing precision because in memory, the float has still the same size. Okay, so with big numbers, you're losing precision. So the same object, but this time very far, and the camera very far too from the origin, you will get this rendering instead. So that's why most of the time this is the camera that doesn't move, but instead the world's moving. So everything is at the origin, and so you have a lot of precision. So let's back to our shader. We will add how to deal with the camera. So we will introduce two new metrics for the project. So the projection matrix to say, okay, I want to display only this part of the screen. To deal with the photon, to deal with all your render things, like is it perspective or orthographic, and the model view matrix, which is in fact only the transformation of the world, so the world will turn around the camera. Because this is just some simple math, you just need to do some computation. There's some new keywords here. Very quickly, attributes mean that the value will change for every vertex, while uniform is a value that will be always the same thing for every vertex. So if you want to share a value with all your vertex, you need to use an uniform or an attribute. And voila, finally, you have your first three models. So if you want, you can just code to get it in your phone, for example. But let's talk about platform differences. So I talked about the delta before, and it's because that is very famous. It's because you don't know on which platform your game will run. So you need to deal with the delta because the time between two frames cannot be always the same. You cannot have a fixed time rendering. So a lot of games engine just deal with this issue by using delta. So you will to multiply everything by your delta. So if your device is slow or fast, you will have the same rendering. But you have to deal with other things. Let's think about a mobile app, so on your phone, and a desktop app. So on your mobile phone, you need to deal with touch, while on a desktop application, you need to deal with click. So that it's quite an easy issue to fix, because but you just have to say that a click is a touch and a touch is a click. But you can have more subtle differences. Like, for example, on a native version, you can deal with left control, just the left control and the right control key. While on the WebGL version, you just can deal with a control key. You don't have a differences between the left and the right. And so my point is that what Kotlin Multiplatform is about, finally, it's about how to unify the platform. You need to create an API which that will work on every platform. And it's not that easy. You can do it, but it's not that easy. And after, even if you can do that, you will have to deal with some implementation details. So even the example, this rendering on Android, first it looked like that. I was like, but why? It's because there are some different things on Android. It's to specify the size of the float, which is not the same size on every platform. And if you don't do that, you can get this kind of rendering. But if you spend enough time to fix that, your game will be will run on every platform. So here, this is just a quick video. The same model, the same code is working with WebGL in JavaScript in a browser, on the GVM and on Android. So fixing platform implementation details can be hard. I mean, I got some issues to deal with that. Very simple example, still with the inputs. I fixed the JavaScript version. I tried the JVM version, it's not working anymore. I fixed it. I go back to the WebGL version, it's not working anymore. And so you can spend a lot of time to do that. Or maybe you are like, bah, you can add some unit tests. Yes, but it's not that simple because in a 3D game, how do you test image rendering and how do you mock? Because there is not a lot of mock libraries that working on every platform. For example, MockKiki doesn't support Kotlin JavaScript, Kotlin.js. But good news, dealing with multi-platform is not only paint, but it can be, you can get some cool stuff too. For example, by using Gradle, maybe you don't know, but if you're using dash T, it will run again your task if it detects any change. And so if you're using it with Kotlin.js, Gradle can detect any change in your code, will rebuild your JavaScript code, and Webpack will rebuild your application and will reload your application in your browser. So you just can code in your browser, you do nothing, and your application will reload automatically in your browser. And to be honest, it's a big time saver. Other things, you can use specific platform tools, like here I use Spectre.js to debug my OpenGL code. And after, the good thing, it's I didn't find this kind of tool on the JVM, but this kind of tool, I can debug a bit my JVM app because I debug the JavaScript version and I can fix in the same time my JVM version. Last topic, it's skeleton-based animation. It's a cool topic, but a bit complicated when you don't know how it's working. So we have a 3D model. Skeleton-based animation, you add a skeleton on your model, and you can move your skeleton, so it will move a bit your model. And if you're moving every part of your skeleton, it will create this kind of animation. But to load this animation, I need to load a file. And what I want is to load it when I'm creating the instance of my game. So I'm doing like this, but the issue is here, it's a synchronous loading. It means that it will not work on JavaScript version. It will bug the browser, and you don't want to do that. So instead, I use a delegate. Delegate, it just say, okay, if you want to access this value, you need to call this method. So what I did is I load my the file. I inject it in another class, and this is in the game. My wrapper will not be used in my class, but instead the type of which is inside my wrapper. So it's like tricking a bit the code to have kind of asynchronous synchronous code. And so in my game, I'm creating the instance of my application. Here, everything is synchronous. I'm loading everything. I can put a loading screen, for example, and after I can start my game. very quickly because I'm running out of time. All of his animation are stored in a file, GLTF, which is exported from Blender. You can have a lot of information, but the issue is the last part. It's a buffer of binary data. It's quite complicated to deal because you have to do know the order of byte extracts. So what I did is I export my animation from Blender, and I created a Gradle plugin which read this file and convert it into Kotlin using Kotlin externalization. And so every platform just need to read the file generated by Kotlin externalization. And it's very easy to use. So I write JVM code and I can read it from JavaScript. You just need to add an annotation at the reasonable. Maybe another annotation if you want to target protobuf. And after, it's very easy to read and to write. So my animation, it's some joint. A joint is relative to another one. You need to say, okay, one joint will be assigned to one group of vertex. Another joint will assign to another group of vertex. You have to move it. You have a reference position, a target position. What you want, it's a move transformation. But how to get this move transformation? Let's do a very simple one. So to get OB, origin B, you can do OR, then AB. But what we want is AB, because this is the move transformation. We just switch, flip the OR in the other side of the operation. So it's now a minus. And it's like inversing the segment. And so in math, with matrix, you just need to inverse matrix. You see to the jitter. So every move transformation are in the jitter. You access to this transformation, and so you take your vertex and you move it thanks to this transformation. And that's how you get your animation. And to finish my presentation, I want to talk very quickly about other game multi-platform game engine. So for example, you have Corge, which targets different platforms. It's mostly for 2D, but you can do very advanced things. Like here, I created a PSP emulator. There is KGL, which is a layer above OpenGL. Or you can see Cool, which is a cool example, which shows what you can do with Kotlin multi-platform and OpenGL. So to finish my presentation, Kotlin multi-platform, it works. I can deploy on a lot of platforms with it without any black magic. Kotlin multi-platform languages, but in my opinion, it doesn't unify a platform yet. Because the more multi-platform lib will be, the more it will create a kind of unified platform. So I'm really eager to know what will be next with Kotlin multi-platform. And voilà, that's all from our presentation. I hope you like it. And if you have any question, don't hesitate to ask in the chat or in the lounge or whatsoever to reach me after the conference. Thanks.